In this video, I want to cover the final section of Britten's pan for singing assignment number 3. This is going to include measures 9 to the end. So measure 9 begins with an A natural. Why is it notated with a natural? Well, because the previous pitch is an A sharp. If you'll remember, that previous section ends with the upper voice on that pedal B flat, which makes it A sharp. And the lower voice is scooting its way up the whole tone collection to meet it. The final two notes of measure 8 are a whole tone apart, and I suggested last time that the dynamics of measure 8 don't directly correlate with the musical tension. I propose that the greatest tension of all of that is the whole step. And this tension then collapses on the A natural in measure 9. Both pitches, the G sharp and the A sharp, at the end of measure 8, give into that strain and they compromise on that A natural. So measures 9 and 10. They should sound and look a little familiar. They resemble measures 4 and 5, but in reverse. So measure 9 and 5 both extend up to the C sharp and bottom out on the D, and measure 10 and 4 reach up to that B and conclude on F sharp. The reversal of those measures is going to also redirect that psi motive. So the upper voice is now descending from C sharp to B, we'll call that 2-1, and the lower voice rises from D through E up to F sharp, which we would call 1-2-3. Okay, let's go to measure 11. Measure 11 is a prolonged cadenza-like gesture. It continues to build in speed and intensity and culminates in a trill in measure 12. So notice that this most intense moment, that trill, is a convergence onto the original psi motive. Right? The F sharp and E were the original psi motive, and so that becomes the trill. I want to reverse engineer our way into that trill. So the final 8 notes of measure 11 span a perfect fifth. We go up to the A and back down to the D, and that culminates in that trill. Now for several gestures preceding those 8 notes, Britten divides the 8-note gesture into 4 notes. He pauses each time at the upper and lower peaks of that perfect fifth. Up to A, down to D, up to A, down to D, up to A. And since we're supposed to be speeding up during the cadenza, I interpret Britten's notation to imply that we're supposed to progressively rob the longer notes, those dotted eighths, of their value. The 32nd notes are always going to be pretty fast, but the dotted eighths are going to consume less and less time as we get louder and louder. In other words, the 8 32nd notes at the end of measure 11, they should sound like a clear result from the tightening of these previous gestures. The 4 note gestures are going to organically spin into the trill. If I look at all of measure 11 and extract only the main notes out of it, and by that I mean the longer notes, we're going to be left with the following pitches. Based on these pitches, I hear that the first 4 of these notes group together. E, D, E, E. That sounds like a single unit to me. It's the next G sharp that I feel motivates both the accelerando and the crescendo in this phrase. So I'm grouping 4 more notes together as a single gesture. G sharp, E, F sharp, F sharp. The next group of 4 notes start on the high A, go down to the F sharp, D, and conclude with the E trill in measure 12. I really recommend centering around D Lydian for these 2 measures, well, really the rest of the piece, but let's focus just on these 2 measures for now. The only scale degree that I'm going to phonate are the main notes. So if we start out with the first gesture as just being E, D, E, E, 2-1-2-2, that'll be decorated. 2-1-2. And then when we go on to the next gesture, 4-2-3-3, 4-2-3. Then we go to 5-3-1, 5-1-5, 1-5-2. And we end up on that trill. Now, this passage is way easier to perform on any instrument other than the voice. But try to pace yourself musically, even if you can't move quite as swiftly as you would like. Let me try to do all of measures 11 and 12.
2-2-1-2-4-2-3-5-3-1-5-1-5-1-5-2.
Something like that. Okay, measure 13 is going to be a callback to measure 6. Do you remember what measure 6 sounds like? Yeah, now measure 13 is an octave higher than measure 6, but it presents the repeated A sharp still at pianissimo. And based on the parallel passage there in measure 6, we're expecting that octatonic-like gesture to continue, right, all the way up to the D and resolve to the A. But instead, measure 13 gets softer, and we're left with silence at the end of the measure. And then the missing second half of measure 6 will blast out at fortissimo in measure 14. But instead of just descending down to the A, we have a D Lydian scale that continues down another octave and a half, all the way to the low D. That's the lowest note of the piece. So measures 13 and 14 have to connect together to complete the gesture. And there's a rest separating the two halves of this gesture. And that's a very different kind of rest than the one in measure 12. The fermated rest in measure 12 serves as an opportunity for all of the energy that's accumulated to release. The rest in measure 13, well, that reminds me kind of a somebody trying to ward off a sneeze, you know?
I can't.
So the anticipation of this gesture is essential to the character of this ending. Now in measure 14, you're welcome to sing a single octave of that Lydian scale. If you got the two octaves, I mean, go for it, right? Do I have that this morning? T of one. As for the repeated A sharps throughout the piece, you can use whatever syllable or number you like. Since the repetitions require clear articulation, I would choose something with a consonant consonants that's easy to reiterate quickly. T would work quite well. That's T of two of one. Right. If you have any further questions about this piece, shoot me an email, ask me. Otherwise, I look forward to hearing your performances. All right, thanks.